أعزائي المشاهدين، أهلا وسهلا بكم. النهاردة وصلنا الحمد لله رب العالمين إدمرا بعد رحلة طويلة دامت 8-9 ساعات سواقة من لندن، زي ما أنتم كنتوا عارفين، من العاصمة للعاصمة، عاصمتين مهمين جدا في الجزيرة، جزيرة المملكة المتحدة البريطانية. وعلشان أأثر عليكم النهاردة، أنا عندي جولة وأكلة مع جافن، واللي هو يعني مرشد سياحي هنا، بس من أجدع المرشدين اللي أنا شفتهم في حياتي، عمالين بنضحك أنا وهو. جافن وهو ال
Hello, Miko.
Hello, mate. Hello. How are you?
Welcome.
Should I say ahoy?
Hello.
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 How are you?
I'm fine. Welcome to Scotland on this beautiful sunny day. It's always nice and sunny in Scotland.
I would like to believe you, but oh yeah, it is sunny now. I can't
it
complain.
Is. 16 degrees we're waiting for.
Look. I thought more than that.
You always recognise a Scotsman going out. They have sunglasses and an umbrella, just to make sure that all bases are covered.
Oh, okay, that's the four seasons. Yeah?
Yeah, the four seasons in one day.
So what are you gonna, what have you got for us today?
Well, today I'd like to show you around Edinburgh. If you look over here, we've got the castle over on your left. That is the castle on the Castle Rock, and it goes all the way down behind us, what's called the Royal Mile, to the Palace of Holyrood House. And along the way, we're going to be looking at different sites, and I'll be explaining a little bit about Scotland's culture, its history, but particularly, we're going to be looking at food and drink, something close to my heart, and something I think that you're particularly keen on as well.
I'm sure I am.
So we'll start a tour and see how it goes. Over to your right, we've got the River Forth. This is an estuary, and it flows out into the North Sea. And down yonder, we've got a place called Leith, which is a port. And it was very important in the Middle Ages that Edinburgh was a trading town, and it could earn taxes. The king made lots and lots of money from taxes from trade with other countries. And we exported things like fish and coal and also salt. Salt was used for conserving food in the Middle Ages because they didn't have any fridges or refrigerators. So it was a very important industry here. Behind us, you've got a view up to the castle, and that whole line there is what we call the Royal Mile. And it runs, it's not actually a mile long, but it's 1,940 yards. But it runs from the castle all the way to the palace at the bottom.
Okay, and is that the Royal Mile what separates?
The Royal Mile runs from the castle to Holyrood Palace, and this is part of what we call the Old Town. Okay. And the Old Town developed during the Middle Ages. Into a very important city in Edinburgh, and by the 16th century, Edinburgh was the capital. Things got a bit difficult in the 18th century. It was very dirty, it was polluted, there was lots of sewage being thrown out the windows, not nice. So people decided to move to this area here called the New Town.
The New Town. Oh.
And it was built by a man called James Craig, and all the rich and the wealthy moved over there and lived in very, very chic apartments.
So James actually built it and to come and live here?
Yeah, this was named after him, the James Craig House.
So he didn't live here, yeah, just he named after him?
Yeah.
Okay, who does live here?
This is actually an observatory, and it's part of the
I
council.
Cannot take
council
it. I cannot live here by any chance?
We could discuss a rental agreement.
Gavin, I like your rent.
Hey, listen, we're doing our best, doing our best. Sort of telescope structure you can see behind us, that's called the Nelson Monument, and that was actually built to celebrate the Battle of Trafalgar in 1805, which the British won against the French.
Yeah.
I know. And
against the French?
Against the French, yes. On the top, can you see a large ball on the top? That is actually what's part of what we call the 1 o'clock gun. Every day except a Sunday, they fire a cannon at 1 o'clock from the castle. There's an electronic cable links to that ball as it rises, and when it's 1 o'clock, it drops. And when people hear the cannon go, they all go like this and check their watch. It's the 1 o'clock gun. And the people in the port down there, they can actually see the ball drop, and that way they can calculate time and allows them to navigate when they're traveling. Nowadays, it's not really necessary with GPS, but it's still
an attraction that we have. Do I say it right? Do I pronounce it
Edinburgh.
Right? Edinburgh.
Mm,
we can say R very well in the Arab world.
I'll learn some Arabic later on.
Okay, I'm sure you will. So we'll say like Edinburgh. So this is a bit of Arabic way. Edinburgh.
Edinburgh, because we can roll our R.
Yeah, we can roll English content. That's for you there.
Anyway, so how about if we go and try for our next stop? Let's go and try some smoked salmon, a classic.
Please, now you're speaking my favourite language.
I know,
Let's do it. Especially the Scottish salmon.
I know. We're very proud of it.
Yeah, you just can't go and, you know, that was my favourite thing on the planet.
Well, here we are, Nico, and we talked about having some smoked salmon, and indeed here we have in front of us some smoked salmon, Scottish smoked salmon.
Wow.
We've been eating salmon in Scotland for thousands of years, and in fact, at one time, it was so plentiful, people wouldn't, if they were being paid, they wouldn't eat salmon more than 3 times a week. So we're very famous for our salmon, and we exported a lot of salmon. But smoked salmon that we have nowadays tends to be based on what was developed in London. Immigrants came from Poland and from Eastern Europe, and they smoked fish that came from the Baltic. But they realised that Scottish salmon, which was closer to home, was a high-quality product, so they started smoking Scottish salmon. So that's where the modern smoked salmon industry started. We say in Scotland, hang in, you know, have some. So we'll just try it.
Hang in. So. No, but I'm trying to be Scottish like.
Hang in.
Yeah, I'm Scottish today. It's the moment of truth now. Really, eating Scottish smoked salmon in Scotland, which they don't say salmon, they say salmon.
Salmon, I'm afraid we do. The horseradish is quite strong, and watch out for that.
I gotta try it.
What do you think of that? It's quite a light smoke, it's not very heavy.
It's very
and
strange.
The horseradish works really well with the
it's
fat.
It's not very salty like saff. Saff, it's more salty, the smoked salmon.
It depends. This is a smoked in Scotland. In London, they have what's called the London cure. And it's quite a light cure, it's not very salty. Do you like the horseradish? It's quite powerful, isn't it?
Yeah.
I did say.
But it's good though.
We're in a room, we're in the Hotel du Vin, and this mural behind me is of two, they look quite nice people, but they were called Burke and Hare. In the 18th century and the 19th century, people could be, their bodies after execution were used for medical science. There was an explosion of scientific development here in the 18th century. But as time went by, fewer and fewer people were executed, so there were fewer and fewer bodies. So people would steal them from graveyards, and you could earn in one night 3 months' wages in one night. It was very dangerous because you could get shot trying to steal a body. These guys decided that killing people was actually a much easier way of doing it rather than digging them out the ground, and they started selling the bodies to doctors. Seven guineas, that was £7.07 for one body.
So, sorry, let me stop you right here. Seven guineas?
A guinea is £1 and one shilling.
Okay,
You're going to buy one.
No. Because basically, after you said this, it makes me laugh. Wow! Because we say guinea.
Oh, you do?
Guinea. It's a guinea. We have shilling. I know that we have shilling.
Right.
So, I never knew that they were called in English guinea as well.
Well, a guinea is £1 and 1 shilling. It was just a measurement of currency.
Okay, because... Oh, so this is coming from Egypt. Because
it
in Egypt, in the 1940s, you would take the Egyptian guinea and you go to the bank, and they will give you £1 and will give you £1 in gold. And a little bit of extra as well.
Right.
A little bit like the shilling, not the whole
thing. So maybe that's where it comes
from. So maybe that's why I really love that info exchange. I learned a lot from you, but...
It's a two-way street.
I'm quite proud to tell you even one thing, considering to everything you told me today.
The Scots were selling beef to the English hundreds of years ago, and they would take small black cattle down to England, and they would be sold in the markets in London. And in fact, in some places, people would threaten to steal the cattle. But if you didn't pay money, then they would steal. If you paid them money, they wouldn't steal. Now, the cattle were black.
Okay.
And the word in Scots for cattle is mile, mail. So black mail was money you paid to stop your cattle being stolen.
No.
The word blackmail, that's where it comes from.
That's very interesting.
So there you go.
Yeah, I always use the word and I never know where it's, like, where did it come from?
You heard it here first, you heard it here first.
First of all, Gavin, thank you so much for...
No, not at all.
..for this, and thank you for the experience, and thank you again for organising this meat to be halal for me. I do appreciate this.
It's absolutely
much.
Fine. Increasingly, with people are responsive to the needs of our visitors, be it gluten intolerance or if the halal meat. And the guy here, Jim, John's done very well. Thanks very much.
Thank you.
That's fabulous. Thanks very much. He's arranged to have halal meat put in the sausages. So
that's very
beef
nice.
Beef sausages with mashed potato, and this is a sauce.
So even
that's going
Scotland
to go with it.
Still a little bit like far from all the generation and all the new immigrants from different countries down in London in the south. It's still embracing all of this culture. So.
Absolutely, and I think that our food culture is evolving, and we've accepted a lot of things from other countries. The curry, for example.
Curry, hummus.
If you go and hummus, I mean, we have hummus, which is a great hit. And people are happy to combine modern ingredients with traditional dishes. But this is a classic traditional dish. So this is a butternut squash, coconut, a chili and coriander soup. So what do you think? Quite good.
Lovely. You know, that face I gave you in the beginning, it was just about, I don't know which flavour I should make my mind.
Certainly chili in
it. What I'm eating. I honestly, first I tested a bit of sourness, then sweetness, then something else. Then now I, after taste, I have pepper taste in my mouth.
I mean, we've been eating, I mean, not everybody in Scotland was eating exotic vegetables and fruits, but from about the 1700s, down on the coast, we had greenhouses where they were growing
tomatoes,
crops under grass. So it's not that it didn't exist in our diets, and it's just that it's become more widespread in the 21st century.
Okay.
Well, bon appétit.
Bon appétit, merci.
Je vous en prie, monsieur.
Je reproduisais les verres avec le meilleur ami, la même amie, like Jervis Gavin, Georges Sosova. Je reproduisais. واو صدق بس كبير طعمه مختلف شويه بس فانتاستيك
واو
we got to try everything now it's onion
we'll have onion. To have a sleep after this
then we'll have to undo the belt
So, hello, here we are again. We're standing here again on Calton Hill with a look down onto the Palace of Holyrood House. And this building with the silver roof here just to the left, that's the Scottish Parliament that opened in 2000. Well, that building opened in 2004 and it was founded in 1999. So we have our own Parliament here in Scotland.
Okay. So that was 2005.
Four. Yeah.
And that Parliament deal with everything in Scotland only, or
no.
Does it work?
In Scotland, we are not an independent country. We did have a referendum, and it was decided that we would stay as part of the United Kingdom. But we have our own laws in Scotland. We have our own law. We deal with environment, some of the health issues, and also education.
School.
And
yeah.
They are separate. They are separate. So that's that. I think what we should do now is maybe go and try some of what's become Scotland's national dish, and that's called haggis. So you ready to try some of that?
I'm absolutely ready, especially because there is two types of haggis, vegetarian and meat.
So we're going to go and check out both of them, OK?
Totally.
Let's go and
Let's
do
go.
It. OK, cool. Well, here we are. We're in the Queen Street restaurant, and this is it's a beautiful building. We're actually in what's called the Oval Room. And this is, we're in the new town of Edinburgh, which was built from the 1760s onwards. And much of the architecture you see here is original 18th century architecture. So we're in a very classical room. And what's interesting is, whilst we're in a very classical room, we're eating a very humble dish. And this is what has become Scotland's national dish, and this is haggis.
Haggis is the most famous dish everywhere to do with Scottish people is haggis.
Everybody when I said to me, did you eat haggis? It's fantastic, it's delicious.
You're all good words about it. So now we have a vegetarian one.
We have a vegetarian one.
And we have the meaty one.
The meat one. Quite often when you tell people what's in haggis, you usually wait until after they've eaten it.
Yeah.
But it's what's called the lights. That's the lungs, the heart, and the liver of a lamb or a sheep cooked in a sheep's stomach. And it's boiled for several hours. And then it is served with what we call, it's called haggis meats and tatties. Haggis is this sausage.
Is the meat mix or the vegetarian mix, which is the haggis?
It's all mixed up. They chop it very, very finely. They mix the meat or the oat, there's oatmeal and nuts in that. They mix it with spices, oatmeal, salt and pepper. And all the different butchers have their own recipes. And there are famous brands of haggis that you can
wow. Use. So who came up with the idea? Who came up with the idea when you guys started eating haggis?
Well, I mean, it causes a lot of upset, but haggis was probably not originally Scottish.
Okay.
But we made it our own dish. And the origins were of a country where resources were poor, so you had to make the best of all the resources you had. And you ate everything from an animal. And so the leftover bits were put into sheep's stomachs and cooked. And they could be kept for quite a long time. So they weren't just a poor person's food. It was quite a skill to make haggis and other sausages. So it was a sign that you had some money.
Wow.
Enjoy your haggis. I hope you like it.
I will. No, there's no need for the knife. أنا مش مصدق إن طبعاً فاين داينين أرقى الأماكن والشياكة والأناقة اللي حوالينا دي وراجل أعجب مني بياكل فشة وكبدة ولحمة وقلوب هنا خلتني من بيتي.
Sometimes when you have turnip, we add malt vinegar just to give it a little bit of sharpness, and that works quite well as well.
So هنا حاطين شعرية وpumpkin. Is that pumpkin seed?
In the vegetarian, yes.
Mm. Wow, it's very nutty. حلوة جدا. مليانة معمولة من مستخدمين فيها مكسرات كتيرة.
Well, what's been happening in Scotland, especially, is that we have a wide range of foods. We've got lobster, crab, langoustines, and we're sending them abroad. And people in Spain and France and Italy are buying our food, whereas in Scotland, until recently, we've not realised, but now people are realising that we have got this.
Well, what you don't realise, you've got actually treasure. Shellfish and all what you were saying to me, they cost like gold. Literally, they cost so much in different countries, Arabic countries, and all the countries that eat fish, they really value their seafood so much.
We've got lots of very, very good cheeses. It's not just the French that have got good cheeses. We've got some pretty terrific cheeses.
Okay, that's interesting because I know there is 900 kind of cheese. There is 400 only in France. So how many in Scotland?
A lot more than we know of.
And what is the most famous cheese like in England? In England?
Well,
in the England.
England
is cheddar.
Cheddar, definitely.
100%.
And Stilton is
and
very
Stilton.
Good.
Yeah.
But we have lots of very, very exciting cheeses here, and we're going to be trying them in a little while. We continue our food odyssey, and we're actually in a restaurant called Calistoga, which is a Californian restaurant, but it's got a link with Scotland because Robert Louis Stevenson, a writer who wrote Jekyll and Hyde and Kidnap, he actually lived in California for a while with his wife Fanny before he moved to Samoa. And one of the things that we're trying here is not California, but we're looking at Scottish cheeses. A lot of people, certain countries think they have great cheeses, and there's lots of great cheeses in the world. But Scotland has picked up over the past 20 or 30 years and is producing some excellent farmhouse cheeses. And three of the cheeses we have today, we have a Dunsire Blue, which is a cow's milk cheese. This is from the borders of Scotland. We've got Kebbuck, and we've got Maisie's Kebbuck, and we've got Lanark White. Maisie's Kebbuck is a sheep's cheese, and the Lanark White is a cow's cheese. Oh well, I'll tell you about that.
I'm a big fan of brie, cheese and brie as well. Uh-huh. And this brie is very nice. It's not brie, but it's Scottish cheese.
It's a Scottish style.
Yeah. So nobody think it's brie. It's not French. Mm. It's made here, like a pyramid. Scotland in the pyramids, all right?
What do you think of that? Quite creamy?
Beautiful.
That's smoked cheddar from Aaron. That's good.
Smoked cheddar?
Pretty punchy. That's going to be pretty
I love
punchy.
Smoked and I love cheddar.
That's
so
another pyramid.
I can't go wrong, yeah? Harder, the texture is harder, not softer than the others. I can have the I can feel the smokiness now. Delicious, not too much.
But quite pungent, yeah.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
Absolutely. And the cheese is beautiful. Got to be one of the nicest smoked cheese I ate. It's very nice.
Have you tried the Dunsire Blue? What do you think of that? That's pretty.
I just tried it.
It's pretty punchy, isn't it?
No, it's actually it's so beautiful because all of the cheeses like this, they're mostly not creamy. Mm. They're mostly dry.
That is amazing. That is
absolutely. Perfect. Like hands on heart is the best.
It's got a little bit of zing, but not quite as much
best
as you would
cheese.
Get from like Roquefort or something like that. And the crackers work really, really well.
Listen, this is my most enjoyable part out of the whole entire
thing. So it's the best so far?
No, everything was good. It's amazing. But this is the best. This is here when I'm like, oh, I'm having the time of my life. When I'm with cheese, it's private time. It's always private time. You know what your lucky gave you here?
Cranachan.
I bet nobody, no one English person can pronounce this.
Cranachan.
You can't say Khan.
This is very easy to make. You can mix a grilled oatmeal. Whipped cream, honey, liquid honey. There's raspberries. You can put other fruits in it if you like, but Scotland's very famous for its raspberries and its strawberries. And we've got a bit of shortbread as well. Shortbread is very quickly a Scottish biscuit, which is classic.
Everywhere.
Yeah. And it's very simple. It's just flour, butter, and
I love them
and
so
rice
much.
Sometimes.
I love them so much, the shortbread.
Bon appétit. Enjoy your dessert.
Merci. Bilhana and Shifa.
So, what's up?
No, I'm trying to copy from you how you eat.
Mm. The cream works well with the raspberry coulis.
Oh.
And there are raspberries underneath.
Mm.
Mm. Mm. What do you think?
Love the cream. Absolutely love the cream.
And there's lots of raspberries
in
below.
So it's fantastic. As always. So now let's discover what's underneath here. Oh!
Raspberries.
It's all raspberries. Beautiful.
And it used to be a tradition that the kids would stay off school to go and pick raspberries and strawberries. And you can actually pick your own. You can go to a farm and pick your own fruit. But the problem is that you keep eating
it. I do
it
all the time.
Do you?
Mm. I wait for that summer and I just walk in any garden or anything like this, I find the raspberries and the blackberries everywhere. They even stay there till sometimes they die and nobody pick them.
Yeah.
So I was like, why they don't pick them? And I keep eating while I'm walking from like just like national gardens everywhere in the UK, to be honest.
Yeah.
Raspberries and blackberries everywhere. Thank you again.
It's been a real pleasure. So come
see
back and see us soon and enjoy the rest of your trip.
Of course, by next time I'll come without these guys.
Please do.
I come alone. We'll enjoy our trip. Thanks for showing me around Edinburgh. I've got to check the rest of the country and wish me luck.
I wish you all the best. All the best. Ciao for now.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Take care.
Thank you, boss.
Bye-bye.